All right, good morning and welcome to Fayette Bible Church. This is Easter Sunday morning. We're so glad that you're with us. You know, the purpose of Fayette Bible Church is the preaching and teaching of the Word of God for the salvation of the lost, the edification of the saints, the defense of the faith once delivered to the saints, the worldwide proclamation of the gospel in keeping with the great commission of Jesus Christ for our direction in all cooperative Christian activities and in harmony with God's Word. It is our desire that people come to place their trust in Christ to forgive them and to lead them, that they may grow in their relationship with Him. We seek to equip believers in Christ with the tools they need to overcome sin and remain free from the pollution of this world. So we are so glad that you're with us this morning, and we are just thrilled to be able to come and worship together. Those of you that are family here at Fayette Bible Church, for those of you that are just tuning in to listen, I just pray that you will be blessed today by the music you hear and by the preaching that is proclaimed. Let's begin with a word of prayer, shall we? Father, thank you for your love to us. We thank you that we can celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We thank you that we don't serve a dead God, we serve a risen Savior. And He is in the world today. He lives freely through His people. And so, Father, let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify our Father, which is in heaven. Take this time and use it for your honor and your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Singing songs of expectation. As we continue with worship this morning, we're going to begin with hymn number 13. I know a few of you have hymnals with you. But it's "Crown Him with Many Crowns," talking about the Lamb upon His throne. It's a good reminder of Him coming as a king someday. And I hope that in our hearts we can crown Him with many crowns this morning as well. Jesus is coming back again someday, one day, in fact. So I hope we can sing that together with that message in mind.
Thank you.
We appreciate the Tom Chom Choir coming in and playing for you. Hope you enjoyed that, as well as the special music at the beginning. We're going to have another special in just a moment from Elizabeth Fitch, and looking forward to that. Just a couple of announcements. Again, I hope you're tuning in to the services today. We had a sunrise service this morning, and so I hope you tune into that. And then Sunday school, of course, our morning worship service, and then this evening, our evening service. Hope you'll tune into that. This evening, we're going to do something special. We've been having people come by and put up notes on the cross that's been right outside the church doors about what does the cross mean to me. This evening, we're going to be reading some of those and letting you know. We've had notes come in from South Carolina. We've had notes come in from West Virginia. We've had notes come in from all over. So I hope that you'll tune in this evening and hear that. And I think it'll be an encouragement to your heart. But again, we're just glad that you're here. Let's be sure that we're praying for those that have lost jobs. Let's just pray that we can get through this and get back to normalcy as quick as possible. We miss you, but we're just praying that God will do a great work in your life and in this as we come together and we try. If you have needs, please text me, email me, let me know. We're trying to keep in touch with our membership, and so you please do that if you would. We just pray that the Lord would bless and just undertake in all that we do. Thank you so much. May the Lord bless. I hope that you'll continue to just worship the Lord with us as we continue our service this morning.
Pierced his hands and feet, and though
Thank you, Elizabeth, very much. Turn your Bibles, if you would, this morning to Mark chapter 16. Mark chapter 16. Of course, this is Easter, and we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let me bring you to this passage of Scripture in Mark 16 by reading first in chapter 15, verses 42 to 47. The Lord Jesus Christ had already cried out, "It is finished." In verse 42, it says, "And now when the even was come, because it was the preparation, that is the day before the Sabbath, Joseph of Arimathea, an honorable counselor, which also waited for the kingdom of God, came and went in boldly to Pilate and craved the body of Jesus. And Pilate marveled if he were already dead, and calling unto him the centurion, asked him whether he had been many while dead. And when he knew of the centurion, he gave the body to Joseph, and he brought fine linen, and he took him down, and he wrapped him in linen, and laid him in a sepulcher which was hewed out of a rock, and rolled a stone unto the door of the sepulcher. And Mary Magdalene, and Mary the mother of Joseph, beheld where he lay." For the disciples, for those that knew the Lord Jesus Christ, this had to be a very, very difficult time. They'd just seen their master beaten, put on a cruel cross, mocked, spit upon, bled, and died. And truly, he was dead. The God of all eternity died. And for those disciples, their heart had to melt within them. They could not understand why Jesus didn't take the throne. And there was confusion. You know, we live in a world of confusion today. We live in a world of the unknown. We're living in a vast unknown about a little virus. But we're also living in a vast unknown about the greatness of our God. Why? Because many people have not believed that he has arose. You know, today as I speak this truth, as I proclaim the word of God, will you believe? Will you trust as these ladies that come to the tomb and they hear an angel speak to them and the angel gives them a proclamation to go and say, "He is not here, he has arose." Will you believe that fact? Because not only has Jesus arose from the grave, but he sits at the right hand of the Father today to be our intercessor, to be our propitiation for sin. And today, may we rejoice in that goodness and in that grace that God has given to his children. Let's pray, ask the Lord to bless his word. Father, thank you for your words this morning, that it is quick, it is powerful, it is sharper than any two-edged sword. Father, there are many people that are tuning in and hearing your word this morning. There's a proclamation of the gospel going all over America today and really all over the world. But may we believe. May we just not hear and see, but may we truly believe the truth and allow that truth to set us free from the sin which does so easily beset us, the Apostle Paul said. And Lord, may we cast all our care upon you, for you careth for us. We thank you for this time. Now bless in these few moments. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Look at chapter 16 of Mark. It says, "And when the Sabbath was passed," very interesting, it's the earliest the women could go to the tomb to properly embalm the body of Jesus was on a Sunday morning. The Sabbath was over and started Saturday evening, but it wasn't light enough until Sunday morning to do the work. The time from sundown on Friday to sunrise on Sunday must have been a dark, empty, desperate day for these disciples. So here comes Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome had brought sweet spices that they might come and anoint him. And very early in the morning, the first day of the week, they came to the sepulcher at the rising of the sun. Here come these three women just not believing in the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ because they saw him die. They saw him give up the ghost, so to speak. You know, I've had the privilege of being beside people that pass into eternity. And we have several folks that right now are fighting for life, and they're looking for that blessed hope. I think of the Perry family. Pray for Patty Perry and Ken Perry and the family. They've given her just a few days to live. But you know, there's a hope there. And as you see, maybe even on Facebook, family gathered around her bed, not many hours, maybe days, is she going to walk into the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ? Going from this life to the next life. And when we see that, we see a finality. And I can't help but believe that these women saw that finality on Saturday and in the crucifixion of the Lord Jesus Christ. And they could not help but understand he is dead. And yet what they must understand is the promises of Scripture are true. Those things that were taught were true. And as we see that this morning, I want you to look at the Lord Jesus Christ loving his people so much that he wanted to say, but believe. And I'm going to give you evidence of that salvation that I am giving you. And so if you would look at the next verses, and it says, and they said among themselves, who shall roll us away the stone from the door of the sepulchre? And when they looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. So here comes Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of Jesus, and Salome, and they run, and they're going, who's going to let us opportunity to see and to embalm the body of our Savior? And they come, and God says, I'm opening up a door of invitation for you to see a truth. You know, the Lord Jesus Christ says, I stand at your heart's door and I knock. I stand today telling you that I am risen, that I am real, that I am true. You know, in these days that we live in, maybe you don't understand that there is a sovereign God that lives and rules and reigns, and he's still on the throne today, and he still desires to show you salvation full and free. He is still the great physician that heals the sick and causes the blind to see, because our God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so as these women come and they say, the stone is rolled away. Verse 5 says this, and they entered into the sepulchre, and they saw a young man sitting on the right side, clothed in a long white garment. And they were affrighted, or they were scared. They didn't know what to think. And as they look at that and they see that, we know that if you look at another gospel, it says in Matthew chapter 28, behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. And his countenance was like lightning, and his raiment was white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. What a great opportunity that these women had for Jesus Christ to offer salvation full and free. See, they saw this angel, and they were frightened, but he said, ye seek Jesus, this is verse 6 of Nazareth, which was crucified and is risen. He's not here. Behold the place where he lay. Behold the evidence of the Lord Jesus Christ. Behold the evidence that he is not really dead. You know, there's hope upon hope that we see life, that we see that our Lord Jesus Christ is alive today. You know when we see that? The way we see the Lord Jesus Christ alive today is through his children. That's why the Apostle Paul wrote and said, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works. And do what? Glorify your Father which is in heaven. May we see through kind acts, especially in the day and age in which we live right now, that Jesus Christ is truly alive. Spurgeon said this, those women were later grateful that the angel told them to see the place where they laid him. It would have, should have, even enough to merely hear the testimony of the angel. Nevertheless, when they saw it, it gave them ground to stand on even more solid than the testimony of an angel. They saw it themselves. One eyewitness is better than 20 ear witnesses. Men will believe what you have seen if they do not believe what you have heard. Do you see Christ? Do you see him with your life? When we see the place where he laid, we see that the Father did not forsake the Son. You see, the Lord Jesus Christ on that cross of Calvary said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Mary, the mother of Jesus, heard that. And now she realizes as she sees in that tomb an empty place with the grave closed, those fine linens folded up, she realizes God the Father has kept his promise. Truly, God the Father today is keeping his promises true to you and to me. It is the place where they laid him when we see death is conquered. Not only did the Father not forsake the Son, death has been conquered. Oh, death, where is thy sting for a Christian? You see, we as Christians believe that absent from the body is present with the Lord. That the death, the eternal death, that is talked about in Scripture for those that sin and have an eternal death in hell forever can be forgiven. And we can have life and true life with Jesus Christ. That life is full and free. So when they saw that place, they realized death was conquered. When you see the place where he lay, we see that we have a living friend in Jesus. We see that we understand who he is. So what does the empty tomb mean? What does the empty tomb and his resurrection mean? You know, as we were putting the cross up, and we had this idea about putting, what does the cross mean to you? And people were bringing things in, and we were tacking them to the cross, and we were nailing all those things, and they kept coming in. But what does the resurrection mean? What does the resurrection mean to me? I've got several things, about six things as I was contemplating. What does the resurrection mean? Well, it means that Jesus was declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness. By the resurrection from the dead, Romans 1:4 says this, and declared to be the Son of God with power according to the Spirit of holiness by the resurrection from the dead. Here the Lord Jesus Christ in that resurrection proves his deity, proves that he is my God. The resurrection means we have assurance from our own resurrection. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring him with those who sleep in Jesus. 1 Thessalonians 4:14 says this, for if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them which also sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. What assurance. There are many folks across our nation today that are facing death. Is there an assurance there? I think of the Perrys again. There's assurance there. There's assurance that when Patty takes that last breath, that her eyes will open and the first person she sees will be her Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. When the family realizes that that last breath is taken, they have the assurance to know, oh, she is not dead. She is more alive today than she's ever been. See, as Christians, we have that assurance. The resurrection means that God has an eternal plan for these bodies of ours. There is nothing in the teaching of Jesus approaching the Gnostic heresy that declared that the flesh is inherently evil. Plato could only get rid of sin by getting rid of the body. Jesus retains the body and declares that God feeds the body as well as the soul. that the body is a sacred thing as the soul, since the soul makes it its sanctuary. G. Campbell Morgan. Listen to that. God loves you, and you as a Christian that have accepted the Lord, you're a temple of the Holy Ghost. The resurrection means that Jesus has a continuing ministry. He is able to save to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he ever lives to make intercession for us. Hebrews 7:25. Wherefore, he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. The resurrection means that we have a continuing ministry. The resurrection means that Christianity and its God are unique and completely different among all the other religions of the world. You see, we are the only religion that has a risen Savior. We do not serve a dead God, folks. He is risen. The resurrection means that the cross was the payment. The empty tomb is the receipt. The proof that though it may have looked like he died on the cross like a common criminal, he actually died as a sinless man out of love and self-sacrifice to bear the guilt of our sin. Jesus' death on the cross was a payment. The resurrection was the receipt, showing that the payment had been perfect in the sight of God the Father. You see, we have that. We understand that. We live that today. Closing, look at verses 7 and 8, because I want you to see something very interesting. The angel gives these women a message to take. They stepped in and they had assurance that Jesus had arose. They had assurance that he was not dead. Now there's something to do. Now, I think many Christians say a prayer and say, God, forgive me, I sin, cleanse me and make me whole. And then they go out and they live their own life. Well, folks, we've got a message that the whole world needs to hear on this Resurrection Sunday. Listen to the message the angel gives these women. Verses 7 and 8 says this: But go your way and tell his disciples and Peter that he goeth before you into Galilee. There shall you see him as he said unto you. Go and tell. The women were given a message from Jesus and through the angel that they were to deliver. We might think this message an invitation, because through this message the disciples were invited to meet Jesus. We have that same message. We're to go and tell. Go and tell. How many of us today are going to go tell the great message that Jesus Christ is risen? Maybe you're sitting at home with your children. Would you tell them he's real? Would you not only tell him his will, would you show your family that he is real in your life by your attitudes and actions? You know, as you've been home, we've been around our loved ones a lot. Sometimes that's easy, sometimes it's not. Are we showing the attitude of love and sacrifice? That's what he told them, go and tell. His disciples and Peter, we are amazed that Jesus wanted to meet with these men who failed him so deeply. Yet he makes special notice of Peter. Why? Because Peter denied it. Some say he distinguishes it because of Peter's anguish. Because Peter was hurting so much. Instead, the Lord Jesus Christ used his name. You go tell the disciples, and by the way, tell Peter I still love him. Tell Peter, no matter what sin you commit against me, my love covers all sin. Oh, the Lord Jesus Christ covers our sin. For without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. But because he shed his blood, there is remission of sin. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Boy, wonder how Peter felt. Spurgeon said this: If any of you have behaved worse to your master than others, you are particularly called to come to him now. You have grieved him, and you have grieved because you have grieved him. You have been brought to repentance after having slidden away from him, and now he seals your pardon by inviting you into himself. Would you come to Christ today? Would you put your faith and trust in not only what you see, but what you know, and what you see lived before you? G. Campbell Morgan says, these women left the tomb and fled. They seized with trembling and astonishment. The Greek word is ecstasy. They seized with trembling and ecstasy, filled with fear. So they fled. They fled with a message. Verse 8 says, and they went out quickly and fled from the sepulchre, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they to anything to any man, for they were afraid. This does not mean that they made no report of the resurrection, because we plainly know that they did in Mark 16:11, Luke 24:9. It means that as they left the scene of the empty tomb, they did not discuss it among themselves. They didn't try to figure it out or match their stories. They simply went to make a report to the disciples as the angels had invited them to do. They simply obeyed. You know, we sing a song, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Today, the resurrection is true. Today, we take God's word for what it says, and we believe it. And if we believe it, then let's go forth with the message of the gospel to a lost and dying world. May we show it in our lives. May we evidence those things that God has given us. Folks, on this Easter, it's an Easter that will be remembered for years to come. When grandparents are sitting and their kids say, hey, do you remember the epidemic of 2020? And they'll sit in their rocking chairs and say, oh, I remember. I remember we had no other Easter like that Easter. We were all together in our homes. We couldn't go anywhere else, but all we believed in the resurrection of Jesus Christ. All we changed because of the changing of the world. We changed our hearts to serve Him more. What about you today? Will you come to Christ if you don't know Him on this Resurrection Sunday? Will you trust Him? Will you believe Him? Christians, will you change your ways? Will we put God where He ought to be in the center of our life? Is He where He ought to be today? May He be. Let's pray. Father, thank You for Your word. Thank You for what You're going to do in our lives as we serve Thee today. As we minister to our families, Lord, may they see Christ in me. May we understand a truth that You have given, that You have arose from the grave. These women saw it. They believed and they ran and they said, we're not going to question it. We're just going to believe it. Father, may we believe. May we trust. May we obey You today. In Jesus' name we pray.
We're going to end the service this morning singing a couple verses of Because He Lives on page 805. We're going to sing the first verse and the last verse and the chorus. I'll just read it through to those of you who won't have the words in front of you. It says, because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future and life is worth the living. Just because He lives. I hope that's a great encouragement to you this morning. We're going to sing two verses of it.
Bye.
Thank you for joining us this morning. I hope you'll join us again this evening as we go through the messages of what does the cross mean to you. But thank you again for joining us.